comments. Preliminary matters, we've had some apologies. Councillor Asher, Councillor Murray, Deputy Chief stopped joining us today. So we have a number of very kindly members who've slotted in to make up the numbers. Thank you for that. So any other apologies to declare or record? If not, again, any declarations of interest members want to make at this time to record? There are no particular matters of urgency, so the agenda can be dealt with in its order as printed. So we've got, item two, minutes of the previous meeting. Those are pages 7 to 10. Are there any amendments of fact? Otherwise, can that set of minutes be accepted? Thank you. So that's agreed. I'll sign that in a moment. We move on to item three, audit findings. We have colleagues here from Grant Thornton. I think you know most of the members. One or two new ones around the table, I'm sure, will introduce themselves to you outside. But if you'd like to roll in, so this is pages 11 to 42. Ian has a preamble.
No, Chair, I'm happy for you to take the report. The only comment I would add is this does link into item 7, statements of accounts, but I'll refer back to item 3 when I pick that one.
Okay. Show us yours.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. I won't go through it page by page, I'd be glad to know. So this report is the sort of report that bridges between the draft set of accounts and the final set of accounts, which, as Ian just said, are later on the agenda. So I'm Mike Thomas, engagement lead for Grant Thornton. My colleague is Praminder Sethi, who's the audit manager. So in terms of the detail of the report, probably best place to start is sort of page 15, and sort of pages 15, 16 and 17 are a summary of what we've done. So that's where I'll sort of just focus attention. So for sort of relatively new members, as external auditors of the authority, we're required to do a number of things. One is to give an opinion on the numbers in the financial statements, which are later on the agenda, which are significant documents. We're also required to review your annual governance statements and the narrative statement that comes before the annual accounts. And confirm that they are in accordance with our understanding of what's happening at the authority, and there's nothing that we need to report back to say that it's misleading. The next thing we need to do is we now have to form a conclusion on your arrangements for achieving value for money, and that is against some guidance that the National Audit Office provide for us. And then we also are required to respond to any objections that might come from the public when your accounts go on deposit, and the public have 30 days to actually review them and raise any issues. So in terms of where we are this year, on that very last item we received two objections after the date that this report was issued, so they're not included in this, but they came last Friday and we're in the process of sort of responding and considering those. So we expect to do that reasonably quickly and then move on to the point where we can sort of sign the opinion and the certificates on the accounts. So in terms of the right-hand side of page 15, there are a number of bullet points, half of which are things that we would naturally do after today's meeting, and two or three which were still in sort of progress at the point of issuing the report. I'm pleased to say, other than one investment confirmation, everything else is sort of finalised, so there will be nothing to stop us issuing the opinion on the financial statements. So turning the pages to 16 and 17, that just gives a bit more detail. Very pleased to say another positive report in relation to what's in the accounts. No changes to the sort of reported outturn position. A very minor number of amendments to the presentational aspects of the financial statements. Probably the biggest one, which in itself wasn't really a major issue, was that there was a new statement this year called the expenditure financing funding analysis, sorry.
Oh, you don't know.
No. and you were required to sort of put that in a prominent position in the accounts. you did even more than that. You put it in as one of the main statements, and so that's just been moved about and recognised as a note rather than a main statement. But that was, in a sense, the sort of extent of the changes that were made. In terms of other financial responsibilities, as we go through and do our work, we don't check all the control systems because we don't do masses of sort of testing of financial transactions and the control systems in particular. But we did, on page 16, flag up one issue to officers, which was a system issue in relation to payroll, where there were some flags in the system calculating national insurance incorrectly. Officers have gone back and looked at that in depth and established the scale of the problem, and I understand they're now sorting that out with the software supplier, so that is not a major issue, but just one on the control side that we wanted to bring to your attention. On the value for money side, there's some detailed notes in the report about the sort of position that you were in. We never identified any significant issues in relation to that, although we have reflected the fact that the financial challenge facing the authority and the savings that need to be made in the short and medium term are significant and remain a massive challenge, but we also reflect the fact that your historic performance against dealing with that and the arrangements for dealing with those challenges have been good and robust in the past, and therefore we have confidence that they continue to respond in an appropriate manner. So in terms of other elements of the report, there was no real other points that I sort of wanted to bring to members' attention. The risks that we set out in the report follow what was in our audit plan and show you the sort of scale of the work that we've done against each of those risks, and in particular against the estimates and the judgments that are within the accounts, and that we've looked at and assessed as sort of reasonable in the sense of, do they comply with sort of accounting policies. The only other point I would make is that we're required to bring to your attention at the back of the report the fees for the year, which are set by Public Sector Audit Appointments Organisation, and they were £32,424, and will be the same going forward into next year. So, Chair, happy to take any questions or any observations.
Thank you. This is your interim report.
This is the final report on the accounts. So, following your approval of the accounts, the other thing we need is a letter of representation.
So the audit letter, yes. Yeah.
So that's in the papers later on the agenda.
Right. Okay. Yes. So, colleagues, are there any questions? Anything that comes to light? If not, well, thank you very much. We're quite used to having a good turnaround and sort of all or mostly green flags and so forth. And we thank you for the work that you and your colleagues have done. And we thank our finance department, as usual, for keeping us the right side of the line.
Chair, sorry, I should have thanked them also, especially this year, the date for finalising the process has come forward, and this year's been a really good challenge because next year statutorily it comes forward to the 31st of July, so we're within those time limits this year, and not well, many have, but quite a few haven't sort of hit that deadline this year.
You think this year's been a challenge so far? We definitely think. Okay, colleagues, anything to add on that? If not, well, thank you very much. So item four, this is the Treasury Management Annual Report. Ian?
Thanks, Chair. This is the annual report for 2016-17. The Treasury Management Strategy was approved at the Budget Authority meeting on the 25th of February 2016 and covers the items outlined in paragraph 5 on page 44. Members of the Audit and Scrutiny Committee received an interim report on Treasury Management performance at the meeting on the 31st of January 2017. And this report informed members of the activities and performance of the Treasury Management operations for all of 2016-17. As stated in paragraph 8 on page 44, Treasury Management activity has been carried out in line with the approved strategy, and the detailed activity for the year is outlined in the Appendix A. In particular, as per paragraph 16 on page 45, no new long-term borrowing was taken out in the year, as interest rates for short-term borrowing was lower than long-term borrowing, and investment rates also remained low. And And secondly, all investments were consistent with the investment strategy, and individual investments met the investment criteria over credit rating and limits. The table at the top of page 47 outlines the investments held at the end of 2016-17 by type and credit rating. Members are asked to note the report, but I'm happy to take any questions at this point.
It's always that point that we've discussed it before, that some of the shelters are AAA rated and some are lower, but they all fall within the government's financial regulations after the Icelandic thing, you know. And colleagues, this has been flagged up to us, we're aware of it. It's one of those acceptable risks in the government. Is there such a thing as an acceptable risk in local government?
Thanks, Chair. To continue that point, actually, I think I've raised this before, but I know some local authorities choose to accept BBB rated funds, so I was wondering if we want to continue on our very prudent only accepting A rated policy, or if you've got any thoughts about accepting some BBB rated sources.
Yeah. What may help, on page 50, paragraph 8, that sets out the arrangements that you put in place in 2016-17 and also approved for your 2017-18 Treasury Management Strategy. So what we can do, if members wish, is when we bring the 2018-19 budget report that will include your strategy for 18-19, we can certainly offer that opportunity to you if you're willing to take a high risk for slightly higher returns. But you know, the note of caution is that obviously the bigger the risk, you could have an Icelandic bank type scenario again. But I can bring that to members for their consideration if you wish.
A couple of other points. I want to say being 0.4 almost above the benchmark sounds very good for the 7-day living rate. So well done on that. As a subsidiary question, is that because our benchmark's too low or have we just done well?
I think it might help to note that actually Treasury Management and Investment, we have a service level agreement with the City Council. So we do benefit, I think, from they have a much bigger resource than we can afford ourselves. So I wouldn't say the benchmark is too low. I think it's the ability by using Liverpool City Council's resources and all the access to information they have is probably why we achieve a better rate of return than the benchmark. But the benchmark is reviewed each time, you know, we set the year's Treasury Management Strategy. And obviously, if interest rates start to rise, that benchmark will rise as well.
And finally, I was just wondering about the public rates and loan board rates. Given that they fell 0.6 over the course of the year, did that give us any kind of opportunity for refinancing any of our loans?
Unfortunately, there are penalties for refinancing. So again, we do consider this, and if the environment is right, we would refinance. I think more than refinancing option, we look at the capital programme and the borrowing requirement that you've got on that. And what we ask ourselves is it we're taking out loans for the new loans, for the new borrowing we require, or what we tend to do is say we have internal cash, and that's our strategy at the moment. If it makes more sense to try and recycle your internal cash over the short term because of the interest rates difference between borrowing and investments, that's the question we ask ourselves. So we keep it under review, but at this point in time, penalties for trying to refinance prevent us from doing it. But we also look at the new borrowing, when's the opportunity time to take it out.
And we're holding money quite a lot in that smoothing account to try and prevent redundancies amongst firefighters and others. But that may dissipate slightly. You know, you've got the pay, whatever happens with the pay settlement, wherever we're going with that, I think it's likely that that amount of money that we hold might reduce. So our reserves, you know, other than what we hold as the normal contingency reserves, the hypothecated reserves, might fall back over the next couple of years. Any other points or questions on Treasury Management? Well, again, thank you very much to you and your colleagues who are keeping, again, our money at slightly higher rates of interest than we could get ourselves. Okay, so that's that. Anything else on four? Move to five. The annual governance statement, 16-17, pages, whatever they are, 53 onwards, yeah.
Thanks, Chair. The annual governance statement recognises, records and publishes the authority's governance arrangements and explains how they enable the authority to carry out its functions effectively. It also fulfils the statutory requirements to prepare an annual statement that outlines and reviews the internal control processes that existed in the year. The 2016-17 statement is attached at Appendix A to the report. On pages 58 through to 65, they outline the internal control systems, policies, procedures and operations that were in place throughout 2016-17. The controls and processes in the annual governance statements are consistent with those in previous statements, and no new issues or processes have been identified. Members' attention is drawn to the significant governance issues section of the annual governance statement outlined on page 65 to 66 that, as with previous years, highlights the delivery of the future-proofed budget saving options to meet the financial challenge facing the authority as an issue that must be closely monitored to ensure the financial plan is delivered. In addition, the statement outlines the potential future governance considerations facing the authority in light of the Police and Crime Act and the Cities and Local Government Regulation Act. As part of Grant Thornton's risk assessment procedures, they've developed a questionnaire in relation to risk from fraud, laws and regulations, and the long-term sustainability of a company. The questionnaire has been completed by SMG and the previous chair of the Audit and Scrutiny Committee, as these risks tie in closely with the internal controls being considered within the annual governance statement. The completed questionnaire has been attached to this report as Appendix B for members' information only. If members are content with the annual governance statement, then the chair of this committee will sign off the annual governance statement. I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
So you've got on page 64 the internal audit, 65 the external review, there's issues of governance, significant governance issues. Everything seems to be given the pressure on public finances, and you know the changes constitutional that we've had this year, and are still on the horizon. I think we've done very, very well. Our officers have done very well to keep us solvent and the right side, and you know to cope with the financial change, and yet seek our ultimate objective. Keep the public of Merseyside safe, which we seek to do, and we hope and believe that we are still doing. So any questions?
Just a comment, Chair, thank you. I mean, interesting paragraph on 410, and where we're talking about the future governance arrangement for the fire and rescue service, because clearly immediately after this meeting, there is the first working party which was set up at the AGM for us to actually look at that and look at the different models which we may be interested to pursue or not, as the case may be. So to be aware of any potential risks that could fall out of that. And obviously, we would look for the officers, first of all, to highlight those to us during the workings of the working party. But clearly, standing alone like we are doing now is probably not an option for us. But again, that's for future discussion. Before this meeting, clearly we had a very worthwhile working lunch, I thought, talking about collaboration really and how we are obviously in Merseyside ahead of the game. So just really comments on that really, and it's watch this space, isn't it, on 410 to say the least.
And then there's the inspectorate that's coming we've always been amongst the top performing authorities in the country. And our financial outturn has always been amongst the top performing in the country. And so that's the standard. If the PCC or the police think they're going to take us over, or whatever, whoever, they've got to maintain that self-same standard of excellence and public safety and public scrutiny, accountability and transparency that we've enjoyed here. Anything else to add on that?
Just to record our thanks, because we know, you know, as councillors, we're under pressure and our officers are under pressure. Just to say thanks to everyone for the hard work.
Many local authorities which are not metropolitan county authorities, are under a great deal of pressure. Their biggest spending line is personal social services.
Yeah.
And if they're trying to deliver fire and other services as well, they're under pressure. The unique ability that we have is we're a niche service, we provide public safety. And we can be accountable for that, and we can provide, as we do, the government recognises that in terms of the advice that they take from us. And we don't want to see that change, but it may have to. But we can bring the high standards that we've had, you know, into play, and we can also show other authorities perhaps how they could do it. Okay. Anything else on five? If not, move on to six, which is the revenue and capital outturn from page 81.
Thanks, Chair. Yeah, this is the revenue and capital outturn for 2016-17. This report provides members with a summary of the outturn position in relation to the approved 2016-17 revenue and capital budgets. The report identifies a £2.349 million revenue saving that, after taking into account year-end reserves required to meet expenditure now planned for 2017-18 of £480,000, results in a £1.869 million underspend, or 3% favourable variance against the revenue budget. This report recommends using the £1.869 million saving to increase the capital investment reserve in order to contribute to the required investment at the Training and Development Academy. Pages 82 to 84 provide members with some background information on the budget plan and budget updates that have happened throughout the year. Pages 13 to 15 and pages 84 to 87 outline the revenue outturn position against the final budget and provide members with an explanation on the main revenue variances. Nearly 40% of the revenue saving comes from the employee budget as a result of vacancy savings and firefighter retirements being slightly ahead of schedule. Appendix A provides a detailed analysis of the revenue outturn position. The table on page 88 outlines year-end reserve requests that have been made, and Appendix A5 outlines the movement on all approved reserves throughout the year. At the end of 2016-17, earmark reserves stand at £29.9 million and the general revenue reserve at £2 million. As outlined in paragraph 23 to 25, £7.9 million of planned capital spend in 16-17 has now been rephased into 17-18. The table on page 89 provides members with the details behind the rephasing of these schemes, and Appendix B provides a detailed analysis of the capital outturn position. Members are asked to approve the report's recommendations and agree to the £1.869 million underspend being used to increase the capital reserve to contribute to the investment work required at the TDA and the creation of £480,000 of earmark reserves to fund 2016-17 commitments now falling in 2017-18 or future years. I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
So, colleagues, that's again very favourable position. We generally hope to have a little bit of underspend to start the next financial year's planning. Difficult to know where we will be this year. You know, discussions about a pay rise, we've budgeted on 1%, certainly a further 1% unfunded being speculated, and subject to government funding, maybe more than that. How that will all be achieved, heaven alone knows. My own view, watch the police settlement, and we'll probably follow that. But again, message to the government, we cannot absorb any more without affecting frontline services. Questions on six?
Thank you.
So the recommendations are here on page 81, 2, A and B, and that it is that that 1.869 million be moved into the capital investment reserve. Is that agreed, colleagues? That's agreed, thank you. So we'll move on to seven, which is statement of accounts, authorisation for issue of the letter of representation and so forth.
Yes, thanks, Keir. I think members were told in the agenda pack that went out, because of its size, the statement of accounts itself, we didn't reproduce, but I do have a couple of copies here. If anyone wants to take one with them, you're welcome, and I'll leave them here. This is the statement of accounts for 2016-17. The previous agenda item 6, the 2016-17 out-year position, outlined the year-end variance against what was the approved revenue and capital budgets. The authority, though, was also required to prepare a set of financial statements in a format that is set out under the relevant accounting codes and international reporting standards. The statement of accounts presents the required core financial statements for 16-17, having regard to the various codes and regulations. And members are required to approve the 2016-17 statement of accounts before the 30th of September of the following year. Paragraph 5 to 10, pages 104 to 109, provide members with some background to the four core financial statements and summarise the 2016-17 movements and explains any significant changes to the previous year's figures. As stated already, the regulations require a number of notional entries and adjustments that are significant in value to be made. The table on page 105 outlines how the neutral 2016-17 revenue position, after taking account of the movement of reserves reported in agenda item 6, becomes £183 million adverse variance in the statement of accounts. This variance is notional and does not require the authority to find savings to cover this adverse position. The 2016-17 out-year spend to budget position remains as reported on the previous agenda item. Section C, page 106 to 109, outlines the balance sheet movements between 2015-16 and 16-17, in particular the movements on the authority's assets and liabilities. As members have already heard on agenda item 3, to issue an unqualified opinion on the statement of accounts, which is effectively a clean bill of health. And members are now asked to approve the 2016-17 statement of accounts attached to the report as Appendix A. Members are also asked to approve the letter of representation attached to the report as Appendix B. This simply states that the Treasurer and Chair of the Committee are not aware of anything that would alter the information contained within the statement of accounts. Happy to take any questions.
Okay. The pension arrangements constantly changing. We've got this independent pensions committee and all that sort of thing. That's changed again. The LGA is managing that. There are we have members who sit on the panels, but I think did it go from a local panel to a national panel? It is so complex, the pension arrangements, and the LGA made representation to the government that it was over complex, but there we have it. Right, so on page 103 at 2 are the recommendations. Are they agreed?
Agreed,
thank you. So then we come to Appendix 8. Item 8, which is the corporate risk register.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report, members, is to ask that you approve the updated corporate risk register for the period December 2016 through to March 2017. So you've got the corporate risk registers in Appendix A in the report, which is pages 121 to 142. In the covering report, the March update is set out in paragraphs 5 through to 8, which is pages 117 to 118. Just draw your attention, members, to paragraphs 6 and 7. Bear in mind that this is a backward-looking report for the last quarter of the last financial year. clearly the next iteration of this report members will make reference to, as the Chair has already alluded to, the employee pay offer, which presents some very significant financial challenge, and also it will reflect new risks that fall out of the Grenfell Tower incident in London. Paragraph 7 gives some more detail in relation to that. So we have, there's 43 high-rise buildings on the Essex side which have cladding, of which 17 have the ACM, so the aluminium composite material cladding, four of which have failed the building research establishment test and therefore have been subject to intervention from ourselves. Just to state members, we have overall we have just short of 200 high-rise premises across Merseyside, every single one of which is has been or is in the process of being visited by our protection teams and followed up by operational crews to undertake a review and an audit of the fire risk assessment and to provide reassurance to the residents. So we run a campaign in conjunction with the response and the protection teams, target each block, and that's so they're the mitigation, if you like, the carry-out and control measures to manage down the risk. I'll pause at that point, Chair, to take any questions that you might have.
There are a number of red flag items, but they're generally to do with national, what if the government didn't send the check, what if, that this happens, what if that happens. It's the usual legislative and political risks mitigated towards the right. Is there any specific questions on any of the risks? Some of this runs from year to year and is the same sort of thing as our own coastal authorities have as well. So if we're happy with that, we'll receive that for this period. And thank you very much. We move on to appendix item 9. Review of safeguarding policy and procedure, Chief.
Thanks, Chair. The purpose of this report is to ask that members approve the consolidation of the three service instructions which are listed at paragraph 8 on page 144, which I'll come to momentarily, into a single service instruction, which would be SI0713, safeguarding adults and children. To approve the revision of the safeguarding policy, which is attached to the report of Appendix B, and to approve the implementation of a workforce development strategy for safeguarding, which is attached at Appendix C. Members, the Children's Act and the Care Act place the statutory duties on the authority to safeguard children and adults alike. In line with the high-level commitment of the authority to safeguarding, we convened a task and finish group back in February to review what were then the extant policies and procedures. The group produced the single service instruction which is attached to Appendix A, which replaced the three which are listed in paragraph 8 and which I previously made reference to. We also revised the policy and they produced the workforce development strategy. The aim is to rationalise and provide greater clarity and consistency, in particular with reporting arrangements which are set out in paragraphs 21 through to 23. And just to reassure members, where there are any immediate issues of concern, they are reported immediately to the duty group manager to progress them as necessary. The policy sets out the training and competency requirements and they're captured in the safeguarding workforce development strategy, which as I say is attached at Appendix C. The detail is there in the appendices, members, they're there for you to read. I won't go into any more detail at this point, but I'm there happy to take any questions, Chair. Thank you.
Well, you would think that in the normal working lives of most of our staff, that we wouldn't have substantial access to children and elderly people, but we do, obviously through the cadets, when firefighters and others go into schools, And so this is very, very important, and we know from our own local authorities and national issues that safeguarding, I think, you know, is one of the top issues that we have to address. This is an amalgamation of those service instructions. So on page 143, at 2, ABC, the recommendations are there. Would that be, unless anyone has any specific questions? Yeah.
Can I just ask one question? I mean, just from starting on page 151, where it describes the types of child abuse and neglect, I don't know if it's encompassed into one of these particular sections, but quite recently on another board that is set on the Mersey Maritime College down in Birkenhead, we had a talk from a member of the special branch talking about ways that staff, particularly there, because obviously they're in day-to-day contact with young people, can spot, hopefully spot, or at least raise their awareness about young people who may be at danger of being radicalised. I'm just wondering whether or not we've looked at that. Is it encompassed in one of these particular points, or is it something perhaps we should be looking at in the future?
That's very much separately under the prevent standard contest, so we can't attend the strategy, and our staff need to receive separate training specific to the identification of those issues and more specific issues, for example, so the production of IEDs, for example. So we're looking at the precursor materials for the IED chemicals and so forth. We have trained DVDs which are on the board of the deal with those sorts of issues. But they're dealt with separately for this.
And at the LGA, we've lobbied that the prevent budget was cut quite radically some time ago. And really, there should be a more focus on looking at that. What part we play, other than, you know, in terms of IEDs and things and others. Well, there is a part for us to play, but how we fit into that remains to be seen. Okay, so the recommendations on 143 agreed. Thank you, colleagues. So we move on to agenda item 10, very interestingly. A change in our own membership and constitution.
Thank you, Chair. Short report, members, but I'm sure you're all well aware that the Policing and Crime Act gives two separate ways that we can collaborate together. One is called a governance model, whereby, as you've heard in other areas, police and crime commissioners have elected to undertake a business case to run fire authorities together with police. However, the other is what's called a representation model, whereby a police and crime commissioner can request to sit upon a fire authority as a full voting member. To the end of collaboration, and also for the purposes of considering proposed reforms that you considered yourselves at a previous meeting, the Chair wrote to the Police and Crime Commissioner for Merseyside asking if she wished to sit on this Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority, and I'm pleased to tell you that she wrote back and said she would like to do that. So the purpose of this report is to ask members if you would approve this as a new member of your authority. If you do, this report also asks you to instruct me to contact the Police and Crime Commissioner with a view to explaining some of the issues in the Constitution and making arrangements for her to sit on the Fire Authority as a full voting member. As you're aware, we have currently a Fire and Police Committee, and that's been working very well in terms of collaboration. However, that does not allow voting rights and isn't a decision-making committee in any event. So the proposal here for the Police and Crime Commissioner to sit on the Fire Authority, I certainly feel will help collaboration, will help relationships develop, and will help us move forward together in the interests of all the communities in Merseyside. Thank you, Chair.
Yes, the danger for the PCC is that she comes here and finds it more interesting than the police. I'm sure she will. This is a discussions that we've had. This is a policy that we discussed the idea of working very closely with the police and the PCC. I mean, it's a different discipline for her, or, you know, for the PCC here or her. If they're not actually going to be physically involved with the management of the fire service, but I think she's indicated that she would be interested to see what's involved, which is good. It's a good thing. I think all of the points are set out in here. If there's any particular discussion on that,
it's development rights. I'd like a bit more clarification on.
There are special requirements that would come in our rules, but there is a.
Essentially, the Police and Crime Commissioner would become an elected member, as yourselves in every other term, than actually being elected to a council as you are. She is nevertheless elected as the Police and Crime Commissioner. So she would be entitled to the allowance scheme, for example, although she has chosen not to take that on. But in any other way, she would be subject to all the same laws and regulations, the same standing orders in your constitution, the same members' code of conduct. Everything that applies to members of this authority would apply to the Police and Crime Commissioner as a voting member. She would only be sitting on full authority, not on any committees, but would be entitled to vote in terms of the same issues that you vote on for approval of various reports. Does that give you a
Can I just ask on that? I mean, I've no objection to the Police and Crime Commissioner coming on. Just, probably it's something to her to wrestle with more than us, really, but where it comes down to a conflict of interest, particularly when we're talking about budgets, because budgets that we might wish to move here and could have either an adverse or beneficial effect on the police service, really. So, it's obviously we'd leave that to you as our legal representative and the Crime Commissioner herself, but I just wonder how that would work, particularly at budget time.
I think you're actually quite right with what you're saying, that that there may be potential conflicts of interest, particularly around budgets. That is why I would propose to go to meet with the Police and Crime Commissioner and explain all these issues, things like standing orders, but also conflicts of interest, declaration of interests, what we mean by exempt reports, for example. And as you know, the Police and Crime Commissioner has been a Member of Parliament, so it shouldn't be any great change to deal with the things that you deal with, but obviously they're dealt with slightly differently, and she'd have to be advised about that.
Dealing with MPs, I believe they'll get leaked just before the meeting.
That's it.
Yes.
Thanks, Chair. I think this, this report and the recommendation should be involvement and the new world that we're in now with this more collaboration, closer collaboration between emergency services and the integration between ourselves and the police. And the fantastic work that we do at the moment, because we've just had snapshot of some of the work that we're not taking at the moment, and that's, you know, that relationship is only going to improve